So good evening, everyone. Tonight we will spend the first 30-40 minutes, okay, sharing with you about the ordination purpose, the discovery of the Buddha. Okay, hopefully next session we can go deeper in the Four Noble Truths. Just two examples before we go to the Dhammacakka and the discovery of the Buddha. Here is the example of one of the monks who ordained in the Buddha time. I think it's good for us to get to know the story of each great disciple back then, to see the reason why those monks ordained and how did they achieve in their ordination. Some of them ordained from the poor family, many of them ordained from the very rich family. Okay, this monk, his name is Ratthapala. Okay, he happened to be born in the Brahmin family, very rich family, father and mother. He is only one son, and father and mother want him to, of course, you know, want him to take care of the business. And one day he get a chance to listen to the teaching of the Buddha. And once he had a chance to listen to the right teaching from the right teacher, back then there were many teachers. I believe he also, you know, went out and looked for some teacher as well. And he happened to meet the Buddha on that night, and he listened to his teaching. And when he come back, he feel like he wants to ordain. Okay, so he asked his palate if he can ordain. Of course, the answer was no. I cannot allow you to become a monk. He said, you know what, mom and dad, if you don't allow me to ordain, I will stop eating until you give me permission. So he starved himself, he locked the door, he don't eat, no longer enjoy whatever he has at home. So he stopped eating, and parents got worried. And later on, you know, parents asked one of his close friends to talk to him, to see what he needs, is that can you talk him down and, you know, let him change his mind. So the friends went there and talked to him, to Ratthapala, and he came out and talked to his parent that, you know what, he will never change his mind, he wants to become a monk. So I think maybe you can give him a chance to let him try, because he was born, you know, rich family. Monk's life is difficult life, so I don't think he can last long, you know, because monk eat two meals a day, shave your head, stay in the forest. Back then there was no temple, there was no nice resident for monk to stay. Life is difficult. You need to go get food in the village, and you allow to eat only one or two meals a day. I don't think he can last that long. So maybe later he can quit and then he can come home. Instead of let him die, stop eating. So just let him try to, maybe he change his mind and then he can return to be your son. And parents kind of like the idea. And finally they said, son, you know what, go ahead, try. And deep down they think my son will not last long. So son was very happy, Ratthapala, you know, seek for ordination from the Buddha, and finally he got himself ordained. And he was very good monk, okay? He ordained with strong faith toward the Buddha. And later on he achieved Arahant, observe precept clean, follow whatever the Buddha teach, and practice meditation. But before long, he success in meditation practice, he attained Arahantship. And one day he met with the king, Korampaya king. And the king asked him, you look so young, you know, born in the rich family. How come you decided to ordain for life, follow the Buddha teaching? Ratthapala was very smart. Okay? This is his answer to the king. Once I listened to this talk from the Buddha, these four things changed my mind, the way I see the world. So I shouldn't, you know, live life as lay people. I should become a monk. So maybe something like this, you can reflect on your own reason why you ordain. The first thing he answered to the king, he said, life in any world, the key word here, any world, not just human world. You think of human realm, heavenly realm, okay, all the six levels of heaven, the Brahmins, is unstable and is swept away. It's unstable. It's wherever you born, okay, oppression or suffering. Life is so oppression, life is so suffering, and it's short. It will sweep away. Even though, you know, you born in the first level of heaven, okay, the deity still has to die and come back and reborn according to their karma. If you go higher to the second level, you may live longer, but eventually you die anyway and come back. If you commit bad karma, you may not go back to heaven. You may go back to hell. And the second answer, he said, in any world, okay, life in any world has no shelter and no protector. What does it mean? No shelter. There is no place safe in the world. We are in the trap of Mara. Death is waiting for all of us. no safe place. You cannot run away from dying. Whether you rich or poor, we are in the same journey. We born, we get sick, and then we die. And the third one, in any world, again, has nothing of its own. One has to leave all and pass on. He know he was born rich, okay? His ancestor also rich, but those people die already. And now I'm following their footprint. Eventually I'm die, and all of my possession will go to someone else anyway. What's the point of clinging on that possession? Okay, life in any world has nothing of its own. This is deep. He actually understood that the concept of anatta, and we talked about that, is non-self. You cannot control anything, even your own life. Everything is uncontrollable. It's subject to, you know, impermanent, subject to suffering, and subject to, you know, non-self, which is uncontrollable. Human, animal, possession, parents, kid, wife, they are uncontrollable objects in the eyes of Arahant. And the last one, life in any world is incomplete, insatiate, and is enslaved to craving. And he was very smart. He understand that. Human being, we will never feel complete. Never. You poor, you want to be rich. When you rich, you want to be richer. If you reach in your town, you want to reach in the national level. When you reach national level, you want to reach in the global level. You never feel appreciated. That's the nature of human being. It's derived from the greed. We will never feel pleased of what we have. You want to expand more business, okay, locally and globally. And because of the craving that run our life, we are run by craving. Kama tanha, okay, crave to have. Bhava tanha, crave to exist, and vipava tanha, crave for non-existence. When he see that, he understand that there's no point for him to live life as a lay person. He want to free himself from suffering, because no matter what, I die, no matter what, okay, you know, my parents, everything that I have, possession, you have to give to someone else. So it's better to ordain at a young age, so I can study the teaching of the Buddha deeper, okay, and practice, and perhaps one day can help others to free themselves from suffering as well. With this teaching that he heard from the Buddha, he got himself ordained. He don't want to do anything else. You see, a man have been waiting for I don't know how long until the Buddha exists. Okay? With his wisdom that he had been accumulated, and he met the right teacher, listened to the right teaching, he got it. Okay, my life, I found the answer. I want to go this direction. Don't want to be a rich man. Many things like this happen in the Buddha time, and even nowadays, people ordain for this kind of reason. Okay? Because you are smart enough to think of your own life and look for what you really need that make your life worth living. Because we're not going to live that long, okay? But we want to spend the rest of our life to do something that's worthwhile for ourselves and for others. Ordination is one option. What about Sariputta? Sariputta, again, is a very smart man. He is second to the Buddha in terms of wisdom. Okay? He is a foremost in wisdom. Among all the monks in the Buddha time, Sariputta is number one, okay, beside the Buddha. And he got himself ordained because of this reason. Someone asked him, why did you ordain? Okay, he said, this is exactly why I ordained. Friends, for the accurate and the exact comprehension of unsatisfactoriness. Okay? He wants to comprehend, to understand the nature of life, which is suffering or dukkha. I led the holy life in the dispensation of the Blessed One. Okay, why? Because I want to understand the nature of life, that life is suffering, and how to get myself out of that realm of suffering. Friend, the path or the journey and the method for the accurate, exact comprehension of unsatisfactoriness is the Noble Eightfold Path. And that is suitable for me. Okay, I am happy to get to know this knowledge that life is suffering and there is a way to free oneself from suffering, which is following the Eightfold Path that taught by the Buddha. Sariputta is very smart. He listened one sentence, no one need to explain the detail. He got it. He understand the idea behind that. Just like he can decode the coding of the Buddha teaching. Okay, the Buddha say one sentence, he can decode that and understood and practice. With this reason, he got himself ordained. Okay, and nature of Sariputta, he also, you know, born in the rich family and look for the teacher. He got bored of what he has at home. Okay, when he watched the show, you know, he feel like, why am I sitting here and watching the show? These people will die one day, and same like myself. And with that reflection, you know, he told his friend Mokkhalana, you know what, let's leave home and look for a good teacher to see what the meaning of life, how should we live life, you know, noble. So they went out and looked for the teacher. Later on, they both found the Buddha. And this is the reason why he ordained. Okay, he wants to make known of the Four Noble Truths. The Eightfold Path happened to be the Four Noble Truths number four. And this is exactly what the Buddha mentioned in Samyutta Nikaya. Whether a man ordained in the past, a man ordained at the moment, a man ordained in the future, a cleansed man. Whoever ordained in the past, present, and future, they ordained for one reason. To what? Break through the Four Noble Truths. That's it. No other reason. So in order for you to gain the most benefit out of your ordination, you need to know what the Buddha wants us to study when someone become a monk. So he discovered Four Noble Truths, and he teach Four Noble Truths. To keep it simple, he discovered something called suffering. And he teach us what is suffering and how to end suffering. He teach two things. Throughout his 45 years, his main teaching is suffering and ending of suffering. It depends on how he deliver his message to different group of people. Okay? When he teach the teacher, he teach different way. He use different way of teaching. When he teach the king, teach the business, teach the farmer, but the same topic in different approach. So now you ordain here in the 21st century, nothing changed. You ordain to make known the Four Noble Truths. So your job as a Buddhist monk, you need to know what is the Four Noble Truths, what each one of them means, what exactly that the Buddha wants you to understand. And here is another one. Okay? Some people get trapped in ordination. Okay? What exactly is the core teaching of the Buddha? Okay? The Buddha mentioned in Majjhima Nikaya, he said, this spiritual life, okay, life of the monk, is not lived for possession. You're not ordained for material. You're not ordained for fame or honor. You're not ordained for popularity. Do you have that thought that you want to become like popular monk? Hopefully not, right? Not for accomplished in ethic, see? Sila or precept. Some people so cling on precept and look down others. Oh, my precept is purer than you, better than you. You're a bad monk, I'm a good monk. You cling on that precept and look down others. Some people cling on immersion, which is samadhi or concentration. Not precept, not meditation. Some people cling on knowledge and vision, the jhana. When you achieve higher level of meditation, you achieve a supernatural power that you can do and another monk cannot do. For example, read someone's mind, okay, can meditate and see your own past life, or something like that. And then you look down other, you get trapped on that. You feel like, oh, you know what, I am better than you now. Rather, the goal or the hardwood and the final of this spiritual life, the final, is what? Unshakable freedom of the heart, which means fully liberate. Ultimate aim in Buddhism is liberation or freedom. Freedom is another word for Nibbana. Liberation also another word for Nibbana. When you achieve or realize Nibbana, you are fully liberated. You can enjoy 100% freedom. Your mind is pure from all defilement. But we have to, again, train ourselves under the concept of precept, meditation, okay, and wisdom. But don't get trapped on that. Don't look down your monk's brother. Don't look down others. Your goal is to keep on develop yourself until one day that you are fully liberated. And when that happens, you know by yourself. You know by yourself, okay? It's a self-realization. Someone asked the Buddha, how do you train a monk? Can you give me like a very short teaching so I know how you train the monk? The Buddha said, yes. If I have someone to be trained, okay, I will train them to do three things. The first one, Okay, whoever you are, you foreigner, you Thai, you from anywhere in the world, once you ordain, become a monk, the first thing I want you to understand is purify moral discipline. That means precept. Precept is the starting point of success in the spiritual journey. You need to know the rules. You need to know the manner of a good monk. It starts from here. It may take 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. Take time. And once you understand your precept, you know the meaning of precept, you know how to purify your body and your speech and the manner. And then the Buddha will teach you to develop the right view. This is the second one. Right view is about wisdom. People who have wisdom have right view. People who have right view also have wisdom. Right view in this case point to what? The right understanding of life, of suffering, of the Four Noble Truths, of the law of karma, okay, of the concept of self and non-self, the understanding life or the nature of life the way they are, how the world works. And once you have precept, you have the right view, and then the Buddha will point you to practice meditation. In this case, he points to the four foundation of mindfulness, which is the Satipatthana. Satipatthana. There is a sutra called Satipatthana Sutra and another one called Mahasatipatthana Sutra. So basically, step one, precept. Step two, help you to develop wisdom, okay, to the right view. And then step three, okay, he points you to practice mindfulness, because that mindfulness will take you to the higher meditation. And then you will realize, okay, Nibbana. This is very short. So let's see what exactly that the Buddha. This is the reason why he himself ordained. When the Buddha enlightenment, he has a chance to share with the monk his ordination experience. There are two places in the text. The first text, reason for him go from home to homeless life is because this one. He said, why I was still young, okay, with black hair, okay, endowed with blessing of youth in the prime of life. Through my mother, father, otherwise, you know, they cry, they don't want me to leave. But I decided to shave off my hair and beard and put on the yellow robe and went from home to homelessness. The reason, because I am in search for something called kusala, which is translated to wholesome. That's the Pali word. Something good. Many things keep bothering him. What he noticed in the world, okay, people get sick, people get old, people die. My father will be dying, my mother already died, you know, people I know. Nothing is beautiful as his father wants him to look at. So he feel like this the real nature of human is suffering. And he wants to find out the way to fix this problem. If he can fix his own suffering, then he can help the world, the whole world. That his compassion, that's his loving kindness. So he looked for something called kusala. He didn't know what it was. There must be a solution. In the supreme state of sublime peace, where is free his mind from all the suffering, that all the worry that he has. And this one, for another teaching, he talked to a different group of monks. He said, before my enlightenment, his life in the palace, I myself, say, subject to what? To birth, aging, sickness, and death, sorrow, and defilement. Myself, I'm subject to this. And I sought what was also subject to the same thing, aging, sickness, death, sorrow, and defilement. He basically looking for something that falling into the same quality, same characteristic. Then I consider that, why being myself subject to birth, why? Okay. I seek what is also subject to birth, aging, sickness, and death, sorrow, and refinement. Myself also suffering. Why I seek for something that in the same condition, suffering and suffering together, that even more suffering. Having understood the danger, he understands the danger, what is subject to birth, aging, sickness, and death, sorrow, and defilement. He seek for something opposite. Unaging, deathless, sorrowless, undefiled, supreme security from bondage. This is called Nibbana. Wow! How can a man reflect on nature of life in such a deep dimension? Think of ourselves, we have seen people born, people die, people get sick, right? people cry, people sad. But we never thought something like this, like the Buddha did. That you yourself, you are in the realm of your own suffering. People around you, human, animal, object, they also subject into the same thing. And why you keep looking for something that unstable, something that keep changing, something that will fall apart. But, you know, he think differently. He said, there must be something opposite. There must be a way out of this kind of worry, this kind of suffering, oppression that he feel, you know, toward his own life and toward others. So he seek for something unaging, something deathless, something sorrowless, something, you know, very secure. And that thing, now he discover what it is, and he name it Nibbana. To me, the Buddha is very smart. Prince Siddhartha was very smart. He has a very keen, sharp sense of observation about life. And he feels suffering, and he feels other suffering. Whoever can understand that life is suffering, a very smart person, you can look deeper into your own life. So you can sense that, and then you feel like you have to do something. Okay, you have to do something. And this is happened after he discovered the Nibbana. He realized Nibbana. So he shared with the monk the reason why, you know, he got himself ordained. Is this the same like you? Your goal of ordination, your purpose of ordination, that you see, hey, life in the world is suffering. So I should find my way to following the teaching of the Buddha, because he is the only one, okay, in the human history who mentioned that we can be free from suffering through our own effort. You don't need to ask, to pray for any beings to come and help you. You can liberate yourself. To me, this is amazing. Okay? What did the Buddha discover? The classic answer you will receive is the Four Noble Truths. Buddha never mentioned that here. This is he explained after 7 days of his enlightenment. Okay, let's take a look together carefully. I consider, okay, this Dhamma, see the word Dhamma appears here. Dhamma has very broad meaning. Dhamma can be the truth, Dhamma can be the teaching. Okay, there are many meanings of Dhamma. There is something that he discovered. Remember, he was looking for something kusala. He didn't know what is kusala. And now he discovered something he called Dhamma. This Dhamma that I have attained is profound. Very deep. It's very deep. Hard to see and hard to understand. Very peaceful and very sublime. It is unattainable by reasoning. Okay, you cannot just think and, oh, I got it. No. Very certain. And to be experienced by the wise only. But in this generation, listen carefully, in this generation mean us, people in the mundane world, ordinary people, who delight in attachment, take delight in attachment, rejoice in attachment. For people like us, we still have a lot of craving. We attach to a lot of things. Okay? Possession, money, house, business, people, land, you know, you name it. We have a lot of craving in our mind. People who live life in the sense pleasure world like us, it's very difficult. It is very hard for them to see the truth. Very hard for them to understand. So he called this the law of causality or dependent origination. The Pali terms called Pratijja Samuppada. Okay, this word is very foreign to many of us. It's unusual. It's something we don't hear every day. It's okay. Just hear me out. Dependent origination, we will come back to this. And it is hard to see this truth, extinction of sankhara formation. It is very hard for us to see that, you know, there is no such thing called self. Everything is a compound. It's a compound condition. It's a formation. Very difficult to understand. The getting rid of all existence. The destruction of craving. How to remove craving. Because craving is the cause of suffering. Not easy for ordinary people to understand. And this passion, okay, virakha, okay, this disconnected, all the feeling. Okay, you feel nothing about it. You can let go. Cessation, removing the tanha completely. This is called nibbana. So two things here. The first one is dependent origination. The second one is nibbana. This is exactly what the Buddha discovered. This is exactly what he explained. If I were to teach the Dhamma, other would not understand me. Would not understand me, and that would be a wearing and troublesome for me. Basically, he feel like maybe no one would understand what he discovered. Maybe it's such a waste of my time to teach human. Maybe I shouldn't teach them, because what he discovered is very deep, is very profound. Cannot just think and understand. You have to realize it. You have to have a direct experience through your own meditation. And he called this thing is the dependent origination and nibbana. Dependent origination, to keep it short, it means the process of suffering, suffering formation and suffering eradication. There are 12 dhamma that link together. None of them exist by itself. They are related. They depend on each other. There are 12 of them. But the point here is, I want you to see from your own eyes that this is exactly what the Buddha said, what he discovered. So you have to keep this word familiar. Okay, dependent origination and nibbana. We will get to that when we learn about the Four Noble Truths later on. My question to you is, where is the word Four Noble Truths? How come the Buddha did not say anything about the Four Noble Truths here? This is the dependent, the picture of the dependent origination. There are 12 dhamma that link together, start from avijja, ignorance, okay? Formation, consciousness, name and form, sense-based contact, feeling, craving, clinking, becoming, and birth, aging, and death. There are 12 of them linked together. You can call it a suffering formation process. And in order to remove this, to end the suffering, we have to understand this 12 dhamma. Then we can work on it. If this exists, that exists. If this ceases to exist, that also ceases to exist. This is the summary of dependent origination. This formula is very important about how suffering occurs and how to end suffering. It's extremely deep. Very deep. The only monk that I noticed understand this right away is Sariputta. When he first heard this word from his teacher, Venerable Asachi said this sentence, and Sariputta understand. he achieved Sotapatthana right then, and then later on he seek for ordination from the Buddha. Okay, so we'll keep this in mind, okay? Where is the Four Noble Truths? And how Four Noble Truths related to dependent origination? I want you to fully understand this. So you guys know the Dhammajap. You have been chanting Dhammajap, but it's in Pali. You may not know the meaning. Dhammajap is the first teaching of the Buddha. Once this happened, after his enlightenment, he spent 7 weeks to reflect on his discovery. And then he decided, okay, now I'm ready to teach. The question is, who should I teach? So he think of his two teachers, Alandaka and Uttaka, aesthetic, who he went to learn the meditation from both of them after he left the palace. But both teachers passed away already. So now he think, okay, who's next? Who should I teach? So he think of the five aesthetic. These five aesthetic, okay, they were serving him 6 years. So he was, torture himself. He practiced self-mortification for 6 years. But he didn't achieve anything, so he stopped. He practiced on his own until he realized Nibbana. So now he tried to locate these five aesthetic. He located them and he found them. Okay, at Isipatana Malukathayawan forest near Varanasi. So he gave the teaching. The first teaching ever of the Buddha is called Dhammajak Kapotana Sutra, the one that he teach. So if you are new to Buddhism, I think this is the good start for you to get to know the idea of the teaching of the Buddha. See, after you success or discover something, you put everything into the first teaching. You're so excited about your discovery. Ah, you know what? Come listen. This is what I found. Sit down and listen. I will share with you. And this is the Dhammajap. At the end of this teaching, one monk here, one aesthetic here, can follow his teaching and realize Sotapattana. So he basically attained the first level of enlightenment. And at the end, okay, they stay the first rain retreat together. And during that rain retreat, the Buddha teach the second sutra, which we will not talk about it today. The name is the Anatta Lakkhana Sutra. This sutra talk about self and non-self. And when he finished this second teaching, all of them, five of them, achieve Arahantship. They become Arahant. Their mind 100% free from defilement. To me, Dhammacak is amazing teaching. Okay, in Dhammacak, the Buddha reflect on his discovery. Because the Buddha was practiced self-mortification with these five ascetics for many years. And back then, not just the Buddha, many people practice two things. To find the realization of fully liberate from suffering. The first technique that people follow is called sense pleasure. Kama sukhalika nuyo. Then you indulge in sense pleasure. Okay? And another thing, another opposite way, people practice self-mortification. To torture oneself, hoping that when you torture yourself long enough, okay, maybe one super being will give you sympathy and show you the way to liberation. Five ascetics also have this view, very strong view on self-mortification. But the Buddha said, no, it didn't work. So in Dhammacak, the Buddha helped them to change their view of the way they practice. If you still following the same practice, you will not go anywhere. Torture yourself will not take you anywhere. It's the wrong view. So the Buddha helped them to adjust that view. So when the will is correct, so one person achieved the first level of enlightenment. But it's not enough. Another thing that people so cling on in Indian time, the religion that people follow back then, or the teaching that people follow, is Brahminism. They believe in permanent self. Okay? We exist because of the being or God, which is the bigger self. Okay, something somewhere, and we are the smaller self. Our job is to purify ourselves and go back to stay with that being, whatever it is. And this self is permanent. You last life, and you this life, and you in the future life is the same you. This is called self, permanent self. The Buddha reject this idea. He said, no, if you guys still have that will, again, you will not be liberated. So that's why the second teaching add on to the first teaching. Not only to clear the will from wrong will to right will, it also help them to understand the concept of non-self or no self. If you can let go about self, then your mind can be liberated because you will not cling on anything in the world. All right. So here is the summary. We will finish here tonight. The first teaching of Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta. There are three things to be studied. The first one is the concept of the middle way. The second one is what? The path, right? The path for realization or Nibbana. And the third one, we talk about the Four Noble Truths. Okay, let's start from number one. The concept of the middle way, that the one that Lung Phi just mentioned. Okay, people practice sense pleasure and self-mortification for many, many years. Many ascetics back then, they practice either sense pleasure or self-mortification, hoping that their mind will be liberated. But the Buddha discovered something new. Okay, the middle way is not something in the middle. The middle way is the new concept that discovered by the Buddha that rise above these two concepts. These two concepts can only take you to the mundane state, cannot go further than this. But the middle way help. You know, whoever practice the middle way will go beyond mundane state to the supramundane state, which is Nibbana. So stop torture yourself. Okay? Stop overindulge in sense pleasure. These two practice will take you nowhere. You have to understand the concept of the middle way in order for you to realize Nibbana or the supreme peace. And then the Buddha teach them what is the middle way and how to do that. And the second concept in the Dhammacak talk about the path. Okay, the path. What is the path? The path points specifically to the Eightfold Path, the Noble Eightfold Path, or the Makkha. It is the path that making for vision, making for knowledge, which conduce to calming, to super knowledge, and to awakening, which is Nibbana. This is the Buddha give us the hint before one can achieve Nibbana. These things need to happen along the way. First, you need to have a vision. Okay, Jakkhu Karani. When you chant Jakkhu Karani, Jakkhu mean eyes, eye mean vision. Jana Karani, Jana mean knowledge. Jana, Jakkhu is vision, is eye. What is eye? Eye is not the physical eye. You need to see from the inner eyes. Okay, vision is inner eye. Buddha did not think. The Buddha see things through his meditation practice. He see it. When he see, he understand. He see until he realized Nibbana. But before he can realize Nibbana, he need to acquire something called inner eye or Jakkhu. Jakkhu Karani happen. And with that Jakkhu, with that eyes, he can see something that he never seen before. In his meditation, okay, right meditation, will take you to the state of calmness, of equanimity. Okay, you feel calm, okay, and then it will take you to super knowledge, which is apinyaya. There is another word. Okay, when you chant Jakkhu Karani, Jana Karani, Upasamaya, okay, apinyaya. Apinyaya means higher knowledge, including the knowledge or ability to remove the defilement in human mind. Okay, these are something that happen before you can realize Nibbana. Who can explain something like this? If you not see it, you cannot think. You have to see each step before you get to the state of mind super peaceful, the mind free from defilement. With the inner eye, with the higher knowledge, then you can be free from suffering. And the third concept, again back to the Four Noble Truths, when my knowledge and vision of this, when he understand the Four Noble Truths as they really are, thoroughly purifying, okay, completely understood, then I claim, keyword is here, I have awakened to the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment in this world. So before the Buddha can claim that he enlightenment, he achieved enlightenment, he has to make known of the Four Noble Truths thoroughly. Every Buddha realize the same thing, which is fully understand the Four Noble Truths. Now we following his teaching, our job is to get to know what is the Four Noble Truths and how to realize them, which we will get to this topic for the next session. Okay, Four Noble Truths. So any questions so far?